Good evening and welcome to another session of webinars on Young India Intensivists. Today's topic is chest trauma, and the talk will be taken by Dr. Richa Agarwal. She's an additional professor at the AIIMS Trauma Center, which handles all the trauma of NCR and is the apex trauma center in the country. And she has a vast experience with chest trauma and trauma in general. So I think she's very apt speaker, and I'm sure she'll share her experience and the literature for chest trauma. And joining us all the way from Singapore is Dr. Monica Gulati, ma'am. She's been there earlier with us, and she'd taken the session on prone ventilation, which many of you had attended and had seen the recordings also. So welcome, ma'am. Thank you. She's a consultant in intensive care in Singapore in Tanjong Hospital. Thank you, ma'am. So I hand it over to you, ma'am. Please start the proceedings.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Tapesh. So I'll be starting with the chest trauma here. So can you see my slides?
Yes, ma'am. Let's go full screen. Fine, ma'am.
So very good evening, everyone. Today I'll be discussing about chest trauma. Now, why specifically chest trauma is it important to us? Yes, if we see the incidence of all the polytrauma patients who are admitted to hospitals, nearly 44.8%, I will say nearly half of the patients, they suffer from associated thoracic injury. So they might be having primary thoracic injury or just secondary injury, but yes, they suffer thoracic injury of all the patients who are admitted to hospitals. Now, this chest trauma, it has a wide range, ranges from minor rib fractures to major rib fractures and to large pulmonary contusions. Even the patients may require pneumonectomy after trauma. So that kind of a spectrum is there in chest trauma. And it is associated with, we know that trauma has high morbidity and mortality, but specifically if I talk about thoracic trauma or chest trauma, it is associated with longer durations of mechanical ventilation, respiratory complications such as pneumonia, ARDS. Pneumonia rates, they differ between 13 to 45%. And prevalence of VAP, that is the ventilatory-associated pneumonia, is also high in chest trauma patients as compared to other trauma patients. As well, these complications also correlate to mortality rates, and the mortality can be as high as 24%. So chest trauma per se has a lot of significance. We know that all these complications, they can occur in chest trauma patients, and we'll discuss how we prevent them and manage them. So I will take you throughout my lecture, I'll take you through the patient's journey. These are the real patients we had in last month only. So these are the patients we had in November, and I'll be discussing about these patients. So the first case is a 60-year-old pedestrian who was hit by a four-wheeler. He presented to the ED. If we go by ABCD, in A, the airway was patent, but he was in obvious distress. Breathing, the respiratory rate was 36 per minute with saturation of 85% on room air. Circulation, his heart rate was 116. He was tachycardic with BP of 90/50. All the GCS was full, and there were bruises and lacerations of the chest. So this was the real patient which we got in November, this patient. So if I try and discuss about how to manage this patient, I think everybody would agree with me that we go to the ATLS way, that is the airway, breathing, circulation, and disability. So before that, what comes to your mind when you see such a case? What do you think the suspected thoracic injuries can be? I have listed all the thoracic injuries which you think which could be there in a patient. If I show you the case again, this patient has a patent airway, but he's tachypneic and is in shock. So what is the most important thing I want to know first? What are the life-threatening injuries in this patient? If I see what are the life-threatening injuries, these are enlisted here. Laryngeal injury, proximal tracheobronchial injury, pneumothorax, hemothorax, cardiac tamponade, aortic injury and cardiac injuries. So these are the life-threatening injuries which are suspected in this patient. Whereas other injuries which are less life-threatening, like esophageal, diaphragmatic, flail, chest and rib fractures can be there. Now, what is important in primary survey that I need to rule out all the life-threatening injuries, and if they are there, manage them right there and then. As I've said that the airway is patent, so probably laryngeal injury and proximal tracheobronchial injury is ruled out. Now I'm left with the last five injuries which could be there, pneumothorax, hemothorax, tamponade and aortic and cardiac injuries. So how to go about it? So the first thing first, this patient was started on supplemental oxygen in the emergency department. Intravenous access was obtained and resuscitation was initiated. On further examination, it was seen that the trachea was deviated to the right. Breath sounds, they were absent on left side. Heart sounds, they were normal. And left chest wall crepitus was there. So it looks very easy on the first go that the trachea is deviated on right, breath sounds absent on left. So one thing we are sure about it, that this patient requires intercostal drainage. Is it right? Everybody agrees with me? Yes. So this patient required intercostal drainage. So chest decompression is warranted. Now, how will you do the chest decompression? That is the most important question we usually ask the residents. How do you do that? So we've all studied that needle decompression should be done. But what earlier it was advocated that the needle intercostal drainage should be done in the second intercostal space, in the mid-clavicular nine. However, it has changed that now we do the needle compression in the fifth intercostal space in the anterior axillary line. Now, why this change has occurred? Now, all the studies of this, which were done in the patients of pneumothorax, it was seen that a standard 5 centimeter cannula, it does not reach the pleura in up to 30% of the patients. So if we choose a second space, mid-clavicular line, your cannula may not reach the pleura in 30% of the patients. That's 1/3 of the patients, you may not be able to decompress. Secondly, some clinicians or mostly the clinicians, they had a tendency to approach too medially. That is, they will not do in the mid-clavicular line. They will go a little more medial, risking the injury to major vascular structures and the internal mammary artery. So now the ATLS, according to the ATLS 10th edition, the needle decompression, the space where we should do the needle decompression in pneumothorax or is fourth or fifth intercostal space, anterior axillary line. So again, in this patient, needle decompression was done. However, there was no rush of air and vital signs remain unchanged. So this patient was tachypneic, desaturating, and still the vital signs were same.
So ma'am, just like to say one thing. So the possibilities were what? Like one was probably suspecting a pneumothorax or a hemothorax, right?
Right. So what are the possibilities? That you have done the needle decompression, but the vital signs are still unchanged and there's no rush of air. So there could be two possibilities which I wanted to highlight. First, that either your needle has not reached the pleura. So it may happen that even in this space, the needle does not reach the pleura, one thing. And second thing, there may be hemothorax, as Dr. Tipesh said, because needle decompression is not the treatment for hemothorax. Everybody should remember that there could be either hemothorax or the needle has not reached. So what next?
So just like to add one thing here, that to clinically differentiate between hemothorax and this thing.
Pneumothorax,
which would be possible, like it's looking like a tension pneumothorax with the blood pressure falling. If that is happening, one is like you showed, there are absent breath sounds. So this will be there in both. Then secondly, percussion. If you can percuss, percussion will be hyper-resonant in your pneumothorax and it'll be the other way around in your hemothorax. And you can look at the neck veins. The neck veins will be fully engorged in a tension pneumothorax while they'll be empty. They'll not be distended in your patient with hemothorax. So that's just a clinical distinction. And also, as ma'am pointed out, please always palpate for crepitus, because crepitus means that there is air leak anywhere from the lungs to above in the trachea, in the larynx. And crepitus also implies, if you're getting localized crepitus with a deformity, it can implicate refracture. So to add that, ma'am, to the whatever you are saying, please carry on.
Yes. So I want to just tell you that these could be the possibilities. So if your needle has not reached, what next? What do you want to do next? So do you want to do with the ICD drain, or you want to leave it? You want to see the cardiac injury? You want to go for the ultrasound? What next? So if you there's no gush of air from the needle decompression, you can do the finger thoracostomy. So that is the guidelines. That is what the guidelines say, is that finger thoracostomy should be performed, in which it is similar like the ICD placement, but you do with a finger. So the finger thoracostomy was performed in this patient. And after that, thoracostomy tube was placed, and which drained 600 ml of dark blood, which was drained. This patient was given isotonic fluids, type and cross match was requested. Vital signs, they improved a little after doing the ICD placement and giving fluids. After this, as you are going from A, B, C, D, E, the chest, after that, the adjunct to primary surveys, your chest x-ray, which was done, which showed multiple left rib fractures and pulmonary contusion. So this was the x-ray which was done after the placement of ICD. So that is very important. You treat the first thing first. If there are problems in B, you manage the B. You don't wait for the chest x-ray, because then this patient will crash. So this was done, and this patient was shifted to the ICU. Now, we know that we have managed one thing. There was hemothorax. We were able to drain out that. But do you think that this patient might have other injuries? Thoracic injuries? Yes. Any patient who has got blunt trauma chest may have other injuries also, along with the refractures. So you need to keep in mind that I know two things, but still my cardiac tamponade, blunt aortic injury, and blunt cardiac injury, which are life-threatening injuries, I need to rule out them. So these injuries, they were ruled out in this patient. How? Cardiac tamponade was ruled out because the patient stabilized by putting an ICD and giving fluids. There was no aortic disruption, because there are certain signs of aortic disruptions which were not there. For example, widened mediastinum, trachea which is deviated to the right side. You have asymmetric upper extremity pulses, and the NG tube is also deviated downwards. Plus, there is apical capping. You're not able to see the apex of the aortic knob, and there's loss of aortic knob. So these things, they were not there in the x-ray. So we ruled out aortic disruption, and also the cardiac tamponade was ruled out. Blunt cardiac injury was ruled out by the normal rhythm, cardiac rhythm on the ECG. So I wanted to highlight this. Whenever you have a patient, do not stop at one diagnosis. These patients can have multiple injuries. And if you stop at one, you may waste time in treating the other injury. Now we have ruled out all the life-threatening injuries. This patient does not have any other life-threatening injuries. What about the other injuries which I mentioned about the esophageal, diaphragmatic injuries? What about them? So the investigations which are required for other injuries are, I will discuss them. But one more point which I want to highlight here is that any presence of a fracture of sternum or scapula, it reflects a very strong force. So if you have a patient who has a fracture of sternum or scapula along with the rib fractures, mind it that a significant amount of force has been transmitted to the patient, and there might it which increases the risk of significant internal injuries. However, this patient did not have sternum or scapula fractures, so these were ruled out. Obviously, the traumatic aortic injury can be ruled out by CT scan or angiography. Diaphragmatic injuries, again, they can be ruled out by CT scan. Pulmonary contusions, they are better visualized on CT scan. And another point which requires mentioning here is that the pulmonary contusions, they do not come up within a day or two of the injury. You may have absolutely normal x-ray on the day one and day two. And after 72 hours, there might be some haziness on the chest x-ray, which are the real pulmonary contusions, right? Then bronchoscopy may be needed to rule out the tracheobronchial injuries, and esophagoscopy or GI contrast studies, they are required for esophageal injuries. These all studies, they are not required to be done in all the patients. Yes, but if we have a high index of suspicion, then you need to go, then the patient needs to undergo bronchoscopy and esophagoscopy. And as I mentioned, 12-lead ECG and continuous monitoring should be done for blunt cardiac injury. Yes, Dr. Tapesh?
I would like to add is troponin I is also helpful to rule out cardiac injury in addition to your, ECG and echocardiography.
Yes, echocardiography and 12-lead ECG along with troponin I. And troponin I, yes, if it is shown, if it's higher, it is associated with worse outcomes. So this is about the other injury. So this patient, we ruled out everything. This patient was shifted to ICU. And in fact, within one day, we shifted him to the ward. So this patient went to the ward. Now, do you think it's an easy case? This patient had just rift fractures, pulmonary contusion. What do you think, that this patient will have just 2-3 days of pain and then he will be all right? So before going into that, I want to tell you what are the complications of rift fractures and pulmonary contusion, why this patient was admitted, why we want to keep him admitted. First of all, that there can be chances of occult pneumothorax. So now what is occult pneumothorax? It is the pneumothorax which is not seen on chest x-ray, but if you get a CT scan done, this patients may have pneumothorax. The incidence is 2 to 55%, which is a high incidence, 2 to 55%. Now, it is important, yes, if the patient is on spontaneous breathing, it's all right, the pneumothorax will not increase. But if the patient requires NIV, non-invasive ventilation, or positive pressure ventilation, there are chances that this occult pneumothorax may increase and may turn into tension pneumothorax. So this has to be kept in mind in a patient, simple patient of rift fractures and pulmonary contusion. And what are the other complications? We know that the rift fractures, these patients have significant pain. And if this significant pain is uncontrolled, it can lead to splinting, guarding, low tidal volumes, decreased mobility, and insufficient ability to cough and clear the secretions, and inability to participate in chest physiotherapy, which can in turn lead to pneumonia, ARDS, and respiratory failure. So what we are worried only in these patients, that these patients may land up in with hospital-acquired pneumonias, ARDS, respiratory failure. They can have retained hemothorax, these patients, which can turn into empyema. And these rift fractures may also go into non-union. Normally, the rift fractures, they heal very fast. But if they go into non-union, the patients landed up with morbidity for whole of their life. Now, another important question which arises in my mind while managing this patient is this, does this patient has flail chest? Now, why I'm worried? What is flail chest? Now, what is flail chest? If you have fractures of 3 or more ribs at 2 or more places, this creates a floating segment that loses its continuity with the remainder of the chest wall. So you have a segment which is just floating, which is a segment of 3 or more ribs. So if it is there, it is called flail chest. And it occurs in 5 to 13% of the patients with chest wall injury. Now, is it important to know whether this patient has a flail chest or not? Yes, it is very important to see whether this patient has a flail chest or not. Why? Because first, it can be missed very early. You may not come to know whether the patient has a flail chest or not. Suppose if the fractures are undisplaced. But after some time, when you're doing active chest physiotherapies, these segments, they become displaced. Secondly, the pulmonary contusion is much more common in the patients who have flail chest as compared to the patients without flail. That is, the amount of pulmonary contusion inside will be much more. So you need to keep this in mind, that this patient can land up in more problems if it is of having a flail chest. Then the incidence of pneumonia is much more. They have a high risk of going into acute respiratory failure. And approximately 60% of the patients, that is very high incidence, 60% of the patients, they require mechanical ventilation. And again, that is not all. The flail chest patients, they have a high mortality rate up to around 16%. So that is the importance of knowing whether this patient has a flail chest or not. Our patient did not have a flail chest. So we were happy that all these complications, they will have a lower incidence in our patient. But it is very, very important to know whether the patient has a flail chest right at the beginning. But the treatment is easy.
How will you pick up a flail chest? So that also, if you can just...
Yeah. So I will let you know, that, as I told you, that there's a fracture of ribs, which creates a floating segment. So what happens, the whole chest moves in synchrony, but except for this segment. So when the patient is inspiring, the whole chest wall rises up, but this flail segment will go down in inspiration, and in expiration, the opposite will happen. The whole chest will go down, chest wall will go down, and these ribs, they will go up. So you will say there's a dyssynchrony in the segment and the whole of the chest wall. So you will come to know about a flail chest as you see, and then there will be obvious crepitus, and some patients will have obvious subcutaneous emphysema. Now the treatment of this patient, the treatment is simple. This he requires oxygen, adequate pain control, and close observation to recognize if the patient is unable to ventilate properly. That is, you need to keep a close monitoring of this patient, that this patient may develop atelectasis, pneumonia, respiratory failure, ARDS. So even if you have 3 to 4 ribs fracture without flail, these patients can develop all those complications. Now, if I say about pain control, so we can have one seminar on pain control. So you have lots of things available. You can give analgesics in the form of opiates, paracetamol, COX-2 inhibitors. And there is a role of continuous epidural infusions, plus coming up role of paravertebral blocks, intrapleural infusion, intercostal nerve blocks. So how to see what to give to one patient, that depends on the whole patient profile. If I'm talking about chest trauma, our patient had only chest trauma, but there would be patients of polytrauma who will have associated injuries like liver injuries, spleen injuries, spine injuries. In those patients, you have to really see whether you can put the epidural infusions or not. So what does the guideline say? The guidelines, if I see the Eastern Association of Surgery of Trauma guidelines, they say that the pain management of any patient who has thoracic trauma should be in multimodal way. They advocate the use of multimodal analgesia. That is, you start with NSAIDs and PCM in the early stage, go up to opiates, and then if the patient's still having pain, then you go for epidural anesthesia or epidural analgesia. So there have been many studies, there have been controversies regarding the epidural analgesia. If I see the literature, only 16 to 17% of the patients of thoracic trauma all over the world, they get epidural analgesia. So although we advocate epidural analgesia, but only 16 to 17% patients, they actually get this epidural analgesia. Why? Because I told some people have associated injuries, some have coagulopathy, some require multiple blood transfusions, they develop coagulopathy, some have associated spine injuries, head injuries, which again become contraindications for epidural analgesia. But if we see the efficacy of epidural analgesia, it is the most effective among all analgesic interventions. So the important part...
Just need to add here that in some studies done comparing epidural to the other modalities where it was given, they have found the ventilator stays less with epidural analgesia, just like you showed us. So wherever possible, epidural is more effective in reducing the ventilator stay.
That is all right. Epidural is more effective, but I'm not saying that straightway goes to the epidural first. First, you try with the analgesics, which can be given systemically, like paracetamol, COX-2 inhibitors, opiates. Most of the patients, they respond to that. And some patients who have rib fractures more than 3, give them the epidural infusions, but you have to rule out all the contraindications, because most of the patients, if you see, they will land up with, thrombocytopenia. The platelets will be less than 1 lakh and there will be some amount of coagulopathy. Especially in those patients who had required multiple blood transfusions. So in those cases, the epidural infusion is analgesia is not to be given. And the second treatment which is required is just prevention of atelectasis. That is, you ask these patients to do deep breathing exercises, encourage incentive spirometry, but again, pain control has to be there. Now, another more important question arises that if the patient has a rib fracture, why don't we go ahead and surgically fix the ribs? That will solve all the problems. Why are we waiting that the ribs, they should be, you know, they will heal automatically? So it's not an easy procedure, first of all. And there are certain indications of fixing the ribs. You do not fix the ribs in all the patients. The indications is when the patient is having impending acute respiratory failure. And you know that this acute respiratory failure is due to painful ribs and not due to pulmonary contusion. So you have to be very sure that my patient is going into acute respiratory failure, but this is solely contributed by painful ribs. And my all my pain management strategies are going fine. Even then he's landing up in this failure. Yes, then that is an indication. If there's a significant chest wall deformity, suppose the patient is having a large amount of frail segment and that is causing deformity. It can also be done in patients who are not being, we are not able to be weaned from mechanical ventilation. So some of the patients are there in which there is, the lung is, parenchyma is healthy, it has recovered, but still we are not able to wean them because of the displaced ribs. In those patients, we can go for surgical fixation. And also if you open the patient for some other reason, you take up the patient for thoracotomy for some other reason, at that time you can do the surgical fixation. And if there is ongoing chest wall instability, again, due to non-union or malunion or rib fractures, in this patient, you can take it in the late stage. But whenever, these are the only indications when you think of surgically fixing the ribs. In our institute, we were not doing surgical fixation of ribs until last 2 to 3 years. Yes, we were not doing the surgical fixation. All our patients, we were not having all these problems. But yes, from the last 2 to 3 years, there are some projects going on and how the patients whom we do the surgical fixation of ribs, how do they do long-term?
So ma'am, you've not had any cases of surgical fixation?
No, for the last 2 to 3 years, we have done in around 20 cases only. I want to highlight that. Yeah. We have done only in 20 cases and the data is being collected. We have not still analyzed how the patients are doing.
So ma'am, which patients were these? They were weaning difficulties or non-union or?
No, they were not weaning difficulties. The most important consideration for our patients was significant chest wall deformity. These patients who had a large frail segment, which is going inside, and that was one. Secondly, if the patients, they were taken up for other things like retained hemothorax or empyema and large pulmonary lacerations in which we did. And I want to highlight that we don't do the fixation of all the ribs which are fractured, only the segments which are displaced. So if you have 6 ribs fractures, you don't have to surgically fix all the 6 ribs. You can do up till 2 or 3, which are highly displaced and which are contributing to the respiratory failure.
Right.
Yeah. So we are still, although there is enough of literature that we should do surgical fixation, but if I'm telling of my experience, we are doing it for late last 2 years and we are collecting the data.
Yeah, like I'd just like to add that on. In our hospital in Singapore as well, like we've had the surgical fixation as a surgeon came into place around like, you know, 2-3 years ago. So before that, I think before 4 years ago, we were not doing it. And now also it is being done only for patients, not for the at the first go, like as soon as you get a chest trauma, like, you know, or, you know, flail chest, like Dr. Richa is saying that you have certain indications. You see first 24, 48 hours, how their condition is evolving, how their respiratory failure is evolving, how their pain is evolving, what kind of segments are involved. So similarly, even in our hospital, we don't fix the ribs in the, like, let's say first 24 hours. The surgeon and the ICU team will really talk about it. Let's see how the pain management goes. Let's see whether you can extubate. Let us know if you can't extubate the patient. Let us know if his pain management is in spite of good pain relief, you are not able to control the pain, and therefore that's contributing to atelectasis. So, and thus contributing to weaning failure. So we've had probably even lesser than what you are saying, Richa, because of the number of patients probably presenting to AIIMS trauma center will be much, much higher than what is presenting to our hospital in Singapore. And but I think the ratio might be the same, like if you compare to number of hospital admissions, like you're talking about 20 patients going undergoing this operation, I think similar numbers would be there at our hospital as well. So although it is being recommended, and it, and also the other thing is, this, I believe, is a skill not available, like, you know, in all hospitals all over the world still. Like when I was in Australia, we didn't have a surgeon who could, although I was in a trauma center, we didn't see rib fracture fixation done. And I'm talking about 10 years ago. So, like, you know, even in the last 5 years, things are changing very fast. Now we have a plastic surgeon who starts fixing the ribs. So I think it depends on the local practices and availability of this service as well. Like, you know, where you're working and whether you have a surgeon who can fix the ribs also. Yeah. Okay.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Monica. Right. So, but if you see the evidence why we started it, yeah, randomized controlled trials have been done, very few. And this also had only 50 odd patients. This was done, published in 2019. Yes, shorter duration of mechanical ventilation, shorter ICU stay, lower risk of ARDS, pneumonia, and thoracic deformity. So everything was significant, but they was done in only a small number of patients. And if you see meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials, this has only a few trials involved here. But again, every trial had different inclusion and criteria. So it also had the similar conclusion that it decreases the surgical fixation of the rib, decreases the duration of mechanical ventilation and ICU stay. Now, coming back to our case, so far, so good. We started pain relief, we started exercises. That's the only thing which is required, incentive spirometry. But now the this was not done with the patient. 8 days later, the patient started having fever. He became tachypneic, respiratory rate up to 36 per minute, tachycardic, pulse rate 130. He was in the ward. We got a call for ICU shifting, and he was shifted to ICU. So this patient was tachypneic now, already 8 days are over, not having much pain now, the pain relief is done, epidural is out. Now what do you see? When this patient was shifted to our ICU, obviously this patient was having fever and high TLC, antibiotics, they were upgraded, cultures, they were sent, and this patient was started on non-invasive ventilation. So you can see, if you can see, appreciate the ICD is still there. So there's still ICD, and these patient antibiotics were upgraded and started on NIV. The ultrasound was done, which showed some collection. So ICD was repositioned. So there was some collection and ICD was not able to drain that. It was repositioned. He improved after 24 hours. He required NIV for 24 to 36 hours. He started showing improvement, fever subsided. He was maintaining on oxygen by mask after 48 hours. So he required only NIV for 48 hours and he was improving. So we thought, yes, we have removed the collection from the ICD. We have started antibiotics for hospital acquired pneumonia and maybe he'll be better now. But again, 2 days later, on the 12th day of injury, he started having fever spikes again. Again, fever spikes going up to the range of 100, 203. TLC started rising again. It rose from 12,000 to 20,000. And some purulent discharge started coming out of the ICD, so which was not there initially. So some purulent discharge, which was there. I still remember my resident took the snap of that, photo of that, and sent me at 11 p.m. in the night that there is a purulent discharge coming from the ICD. So we got the CT scan done there and then at night only. So this is the CT scan showed the infected collection and the lower lobe collapse in atelectasis because of that. So there was an infected collection, like the collection had turned into empyema, and there was collapse and consolidation of the lower lobe. Now this patient was operated upon, the VATS was done, thoracotomy was done next day, and this collection was removed. Now you can see that this patient is still intubated and he had now two ICDs and this collection has been removed. He was taken for thoracotomy and this was done. He remained on the ventilator for 2 days, improved significantly after that and was extubated. So this was after three more days, the chest tubes, they were removed. This is a and the patient was discharged on 23 days after injury. So this was a simple patient who had rib fractures and pulmonary contusions, but it had landed up in all the complications, which we know that it landed up with the hospital acquired pneumonia and then empyema, and had to undergo thoracotomy for the empyema. So this is how a rib fracture can patient can have the complications. Now coming to next.
Did the cultures reveal anything?
Yes, the cultures, they revealed Staph aureus in the first go. When the first time he was, he came to our ICU and we had started him on Zosyn and Tagocid. And the next time in the cultures again, which are ICT cultures, again, it grew a Staph aureus.
So the cultures means came from the ICT the first time or the blood cultures?
The first time it was the blood culture. And the second time it was the ICT culture, and the blood culture did not grow anything second time. But so the first,
how did you get the Staph in the first instance? Were there any open wounds?
There was no open wound. That was very surprising. We normally have gram negative infections.
Yeah.
But this patient had Staph aureus because and he responded very nicely to Tagocid.
So the first was not epidermis, it was Staph, the first blood culture.
Yes.
So that was at 72 hours of admission.
That was eight days. What I'm trying to say is that eight days that he was fine. After 8 days, he developed.
No, that is bacteremia occurring because there is a tendency, ma'am, when you have pneumothorax, it gets infected if the blood doesn't get drained properly. And the commonest organism is Staph aureus. Hematoma collection, you know, if there is persistent blood or hematoma, the commonest organism is Staph. That should be borne in mind by all our audience. And you need to. Staph, whenever there's a hematoma and you are getting fever, the Staph infection is very common, and that is what happened. There was a Staph empyema, and subsequently there was a bacteremia.
Yes. So that is an important thing, which we all think that the patient will be having gram negative, but this patient had gram positive infection. Right. So coming to the next case, that was also interesting case. And Dr. Tapesh, I want to say that all these came in November, last month only. So this
That's
was
fine, ma'am. That is why we all sit together and help each other.
So this is a 17-year-old patient. He was brought to the ED with an alleged history of multiple stabs on the chest. So he had multiple stabs in the night and he was brought to the ED. On examination, his airway was patent, respiratory rate 34, tachypneic, bilateral decreased air entry, SpO2 was 84% of room air, his tachycardic, BP 80 by 50 in shock, and GCS by 15 by 15. And he had bilateral stab wounds over the chest. So this patient was brought to the EDF. If I ask the audience here, so how would you go about it? Again, what are the suspicious injuries? Again, the same list of injuries as the airway was patent. So laryngeal injury and proximal bronchial injuries ruled out. And again, we are left with pneumothorax, hemothorax, cardiac tamponade, and aortic kinship, blunt aortic kinship.
Just one thing. You must be seeing these laryngeal injuries and proximal tracheobronchial because you get so much trauma. Just enough. Yes. How do you go about managing these? If you can just tell the audience.
Okay. So all these patients who have laryngeal injuries, they usually present with the threatened airway. Or sometimes obstructed airway. So most of the time that is threatened, the patients, they are not able to speak. They have hoarse voice. You can feel the laryngeal crepitus. There is stridor. And there is upper airway obstruction, like paradoxical breathing. So we have seen all those patients who come with the laryngeal injuries. And the most common cause sometimes seen, which is only in India, that is when there is a kite flying season. So the patient, the thread of the kite that just strangulates the neck, or sometimes you have the patients who were attempting suicide or throttling injuries, neck throttling injuries. So they come, so they have stridor, noisy breathing, harsh sounds, not able to speak, paradoxical breathing, and laryngeal crepitus. So this is how we come to know. So the first attempt is obviously we try to secure the airway by intubation. But if we are not able to perform that, then we straightway go to the tracheostomy. We do the surgical tracheostomy in these patients in the emergency department only. Okay. So again, these were the suspected injuries in this patient. So as this patient was again tachypneic, supplemental oxygen was started, intravenous access was obtained. On further examination, the trachea was central, but the breath sounds, they were decreased bilateral, and the heart sounds, they were distant. We were not able to hear the heart sounds much, but again, in the emergency busy ED, you are not able to hear the heart sounds clearly very often. So bilateral ICD was inserted in this patient. So this bilateral ICD, and on one side you had air gush, on right side, on left side there was hemothorax. So there was decreased by air entry, multiple stabs. So on one side you had air gush, and on the other side, hemothorax. The FAST was done with short fluid in the pericardium. As the patient was highly unstable, he was not responding to our treatment modalities there. So he was taken to the OR, and emergency thoracotomy was done. Now, I want to emphasize here that it is important that these patients land up in emergency thoracotomy. The normally incision is given as the clamshell incision. So what is it, this incision? They straightway goes from this side, one side to the other. And in this, in the patient who is unstable, the chest trauma would give this incision to open the chest so that we can manage the pulmonary hemorrhage also and the cardiac hemorrhage also. So now you can do so many things with this incision, clamshell incision, that you can relieve the cardiac tamponade, you can do the repair of cardiac injuries, you can control the thoracic hemorrhage, and you can also do the open cardiac massage in case the patient goes into cardiac arrest. And you can control the abdominal hemorrhage by cross clamping of the descending thoracic aorta. So that's why this clamshell incision is given in patient, and emergency thoracotomy is done. Now, emergency thoracotomy is done. Then this patient gave us the time to take him to the OR and do the emergency thoracotomy. But otherwise, in our institute, we have done emergency thoracotomy in the emergency department itself, in the patients who had come landed up with the cardiac arrest. So the patients who come with cardiac arrest, and we think that the thoracic trauma is the cause of arrest, then we take the patient for emergency thoracotomy in the ED itself.
Just one or two questions. So these patients who come in cardiac arrest, how? So you have any data or any recollection of the response to EDT?
Yeah, for the EDT, so we had done 7 EDT and two patients.
Cardiac arrest patients coming in cardiac arrest.
Yeah. So in cardiac arrest patient, or in just, you know, the patients who are on verge of cardiac arrest, you know, agonal breathing, pulseless electrical activity, because that is the most common activity. So in only two patients we were able to revive, and that too of the penetrating chest trauma. So there is a role.
Good. That is very good, actually. That's very good. So ma'am, about the control of this abdominal hemorrhage by cross clamping, there's a new technique, REBOA, as you might be knowing, REB.
REBOA is there. We still don't have it in our institute, but we are acquiring it. So, that is mainly for the.
I just wanted to know whether you were using it, because this is also recommended now. And though it's a little controversial, but it is definitely one of the newer strategies to control hemorrhage and perform surgeries in upper chest injuries, etc. It's for the audience, it's REBOA. It's called resuscitative endovascular balloon occlusion technology. And you inflate a balloon, partially inflate a balloon below the thoracic aorta, and control the hemorrhage distal to the aorta, downstream. So, and the blood flow upstream, that is to the brain and the heart, improves, and you're able to perform whatever surgery you want to do.
Yes. So this patient was taken for emergency thoracotomy, and this patient had everything. You know, he had this lower lobe lacerations of the left side, and 3 stabs in the right atria, which were repaired. So that there were 3 stabs, and the blood was coming out from those stabs into the pericardium. These were repaired, and the lower lobe lacerations of the left lung, they were repaired. And then this patient was shifted to our ICU. He remained on ventilator for 2 days, received multiple transfusions, and was extubated on day 3. So he was extubated on day 3, and this X-ray was after extubation. So he was doing fine. If you can see, these are the clamshell incision sutures or staples which are there. So this patient was extubated, and then had, on day 3 after extubation, 6 hours after extubation, he had left lung collapsed. Now, this is very obvious. The patients who had the thoracotomy, they may land up with lung collapse the day after or even 24 hours after the extubation. The reason was difficulty in coughing out. Now, this patient had such a big incision right from there to this. And although we were giving pain relief, but that was not enough for this patient. He was not able to breathe properly and there was difficulty in coughing out. So he had lung collapse on the left side. A wake bronchoscopy was done. The mucus plug was removed and the post bronchoscopy chest x-ray in the same day with two ICDs on C2 here and one ICD here. It showed some improvement. However, again, 2 days later, there was a repeated collapse of the left lung. So it improved. We put the patient on NIV. However, it collapsed again after 2 days. Now, the possible reasons here, again, this patient was not doing incentive spirometry enough. And one more thing which I want to highlight is that he was in negative balance. So any chest trauma patient, any thoracic injury patient, we tend to keep the patient in negative balance. Yes, that the compliance of lung should be good. So try to, but we should be aware that if you try to keep the patient in a large amount of negative balance, these patients, they may have inspissated secretions. The secretions, they become thick and the patient is not able to cough out. So you have to be very careful about optimizing the fluid strategy in these patients. Moreover, this patient was drug addict and alcoholic. He used to take smack and he was alcoholic. So he was delirious and not listening to us, not uncooperative. So he had a lung collapse again. This time we planned elective intubation. We intubated the patient and bronchoscopy was done after intubation. Bowel was also taken. The post bronchoscopy chest x-ray was good as there were thick mucus plug which was there, which was removed after bronchoscopy. So these 2 points are important. Adequate pain control, the patient should be totally cooperative when you're extubating such kind of patients and should be in optimal balance, fluid balance.
Just one small thing, ma'am, that for the audience is that these patients should be kept in such a way that the collapsed lung remains somewhat up laterally. You know, if you put them in a lateral position, the collapsed lung should remain upwards wherever possible, not in that position, so that secretions drain out. And yes, patient perfusion is also better.
Dr. Tapir, yes, this was the x-ray which was done in the morning around 9 a.m. We did all that. We did the physiotherapy, suctioning. We didn't want to intubate him. But then in the evening, we saw that this condition was similar. We did the ultrasound. The lung was still collapsed. So we intubated him in the evening and then he was taken up for the bronchoscopy and was done. And after bronchoscopy, obviously, when the thick mucus secretions were removed, the chest opened up. Now the bowel which was taken, now it grew Klebsiella pneumonia, now which was sensitive to meropenem. The antibiotics, they were changed accordingly. He improved and he was extubated on day 3 of bronchoscopy. What was good to see that we had given him buprenorphine patch also as he was addict, and his GCS also improved after the patch. His GCS improved. He was more cooperative, more coherent, and we were able to extubate him this time. However, again, after 2 days, he started having fever spikes after extubation. Chest x-ray showed new infiltrates on the right side. Now, the whole time we were dealing with the left side now, but he developed VAP on the right side this time. There were new infiltrates on the right side. The ET secretions, they were sent again. They were sent just before the extubation. It grew acinetobacter baumannii, and the antibiotics, they were upgraded. So what point I want to highlight, it is not that the injured lung will develop a VAP or HAP, the uninjured lung may also develop VAP. So that is very important to know in these kind of a patients. So we managed him primarily by doing the atrial rupture repair and lung laceration repair, but then he landed up with collapsed lung, thick secretions and pneumonia. And he improved after some time. We changed to antibiotics. They were upgraded and he is improved after that. So this we need to keep in mind that VAP in chest trauma is 4 times more common than in non-trauma patients. Incidence varies. It varies from 8% to 50%. But if I talk about only thoracic trauma patients, around 25% of the patients, they get develop VAP. 25% of the patients who go in on ventilator, they develop VAP. Now, predisposing factor for the development of VAP, it is also a predisposing factor for the development of ARDS and multiple organ failure. Prevention, again, you have to follow the same VAP bundle for every patient as you do in non-trauma patients. Our organisms mostly for VAP are the gram-negative bacteria like Acinetobacter, Klebsiella, and Pseudomonas. This was a now this patient has totally recovered and we are going to discharge him after 2 days, the second patient. Now this is case three. That is also an interesting case. This was a 21-year-old patient with chest trauma who presented to ED with bilateral rib fractures, and he had bilateral ICDs in C2 from outside. He had initially gone to some other hospital and there were ICDs already placed and he was shifted to our hospital. So day five of lung, on day five, were, he came to us. And on day five of lung injury, we saw that there was collapse of right lower lobe. Right lower lobe collapse and consolidation. However, after shifting, just hours after shifting, he developed tachypnea and tachycardia. So ultrasound was done. And after that, a chest x-ray was done, which showed a pneumothorax. So here you can see the pneumothorax. So the ICD was there, it was draining, the column was moving, still the patient developed pneumothorax 5 days after injury. So we also know, we need to keep in mind that injured lung, it is predisposed to air leak. So whenever there is increase in pressures, despite ICD, the patient may develop pneumothorax. Spontaneously breathing patient may develop pneumothorax at the time when he coughs, there is increase in the pressure because of any thick secretions. So he developed a pneumothorax in the night. So what was done? Again, when we saw that this is a pneumothorax, ICD was repositioned. It was seen that the ICD was it was kinked from outside. So it was repositioned, gush of air came out. However, the lung did not expand. So this is the X-ray in which we are showing that the ICD was placed again. It is working nicely now, but the lung did not expand even after the gush of air. So this was the collapsed lung. So this patient was intubated and kept on positive pressure ventilation, and the lung opened up after positive pressure ventilation. Now, what to do when you have an ICD in situ and the patient develops pneumothorax? So what are the causes? So there can be two important causes. That is, either there's a persistent air leak, which is there and which is preventing reinflation. And the amount of air leak is more than what ICD is draining. Secondly, there is a collapsed lung because of inherent thickened secretions. So if there is a persistent air leak, what you can do, you can apply a suction, low pressure suction, thoracic suction with a pressure of 30 to 50 centimeters of water that can be applied for the air leak. And if there's a collapsed lung, which is collapsed because of the inherent mucus plug, that will not open up even with the ICD. So you have to do bronchoscopy or a good chest physiotherapy to open up the collapsed lung. So this we see, so in this patient, we intubated him and kept him in positive pressure and the lung opened up. Now this patient is doing fine on ventilator. Now, this is about what to do when the patient has persistent pneumothorax after ICD. Now, another important condition which we see in our ICUs, in trauma ICUs, that patient have continuous air leaks through the ICDs. So some patients, we have put the ICD initial, there's a gush of air, and then there's a continuous air leak. So what are the problems? What are the reasons for that? Either there could be circuit malfunction. There is some leak in the circuit, that is from where the ICD is going into the skin to the ICD is connected to the bottle. So you have to see whether where are the air leaks. And secondly, they can be leak from the bronchopleural fistula or severe lung laceration. The patient has developed such a massive lung laceration that the amount of leak is very high. So always remember that if there's a small leak, the minor fistula heals spontaneously. You don't need to do anything for that. But the major fistula, you can put another chest tube, you can put a second chest tube. And always remember, do not place suction on the chest tube. Some people will say that we apply a suction so that the air leak is taken care of. But there will be more leak if you apply a suction onto the chest tube. So put a second chest tube, do not apply a suction. And obviously, if there's a bronchopleural fistula, the main aim or goal of mechanical ventilation is to minimize the flow across the fistula by keeping the airway pressures low. How we can do that low airway pressures? As we manage any other bronchopleural fistula, like keeping the low tidal volumes, minimizing the PEEP, keeping the short inspiratory time so that the pressure, mean airway pressure is low. Ideally, spontaneously breathing is better for these patients if they are able to manage. And we can have some amount of permissive hypercapnia. So they take some time. It might take 10 to 14 days for these kind of fistula to heal. Just two or three lines I wanted to speak about ARDS also. There's patients who developed ARDS. I'm not presenting a case regarding that. That the patients of trauma, they can develop ARDS in two time zones. First is the early ARDS, which is attributed to the hemorrhagic shock and capillary leak and develops within 48 hours. So you may have patients who have chest trauma and they developed ARDS within 48 hours. And second, those who developed after a week because of pneumonia and they developed multiple organ failure. So the mortality rate is similar, but what is interesting about the post-traumatic ARDS is that it is different. Is it different? Yes. The patients, they are young with few comorbidities. They have lower levels of serum biomarkers and the mortality is very low. So you always remember that the ARDS is common in trauma patients, but the mortality is not that high as in other ARDS. That is a good thing about ARDS, about trauma. And important question when arise while managing, you manage the ARDS as same in the same way as you manage the ARDS in a normal patient. I'm not going into ventilatory details because they have been dealt with in earlier lectures. But one more question which arises here, can you prone the trauma patients? Can you do that? Actually, yes. Most of the patients, most of the residents, they think that we cannot prone the patients who have multiple rib fractures or pulmonary contusions. You can prone trauma patients. Even in the ProSeva trials, the contraindications for trauma patients were if they had a huge ICP, ICP more than 30, if they had unstable fractures of the spine, femur, or pelvis. So if they have the unstable fractures, then you don't prone. If they have burns or facial trauma, if you have a not a small facial trauma, but a major facial trauma, or if they have undergone recent sternotomy, or if they have chest tubes which are anteriorly placed and have active air leak. Only these are the contraindications in which you can not prone the patients. Otherwise, you can prone all the trauma patients. It is also safe in the patients who have undergone abdominal surgeries. So this is just one picture I wanted to show of multiple trauma patients who had rib fractures and pelvis fractures and AR who developed ARDS and we could prone him nicely and ventilate him. And the last slide I wanted to tell you about something about aortic injury. So that is a misconception that if there's an aortic injury, the patient will be hemodynamically unstable. No, if there's an aortic injury, the patient dies either on the spot or if he comes, then it is a contained hematoma and the patient is not hemodynamically unstable. That needs to be kept in mind. And the possible mechanism for aortic injury is sudden deacceleration, which is suppose a patient is moving in a high speed motor vehicle and it crashes or there's a fall. It can lead to blunt aortic injuries. They are usually are not hemodynamically unstable. So you need to have a high index of suspicion in all the patients who have such mechanism of injury that they might have aortic injury. And if a patient with known traumatic disruption that you know that this patient has an aortic injury, he becomes hypotensive in your ICU, then do not think that the aortic rupture has occurred because then that will not give you any time. Always consider that there is some other or solid organ injury or there is some other source of bleeding which is causing hypotension and treat that. So don't think that if the patient is becoming hypotensive, I cannot do anything. This patient has aortic injury. Maybe that is rupturing. No, some other organ maybe is having liver injury or spleen injury that is bleeding. So need to control that. Again, the treatment before a definitive procedure like stenting is done, we give short-acting beta blockers such as esmolol or labetalol to control the blood pressure and heart rate. So that is important about the aortic injuries. That is all I wanted to share. My experience about chest trauma. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Ma'am, for your wonderful presentation, excellent cases, real-time cases, and it's very complicated, especially the second one, where you have done an emergency thoracotomy and you manage the patients very, very well. Really interesting and very informative. Thank you very much. So guys, please type your questions while we carry on with our discussion. So over to you, Monica ma'am, if you want to share your experience, especially regarding any cardiac injuries, you know, because I think ma'am has covered chest well, but you want to talk a little about cardiac injuries, your experience?
Yeah, like, you know, the hospital where I work in is connected to a bigger hospital, which is the major trauma center. So if we have really a patient who's that answer, like we don't have cardiothoracic surgery in our center. So, and the nearby center is just 10 minutes away. So if you do get a patient with a penetrating injury to the heart, and, you know, just like Dr. Richa had a very good patient there and it needs emergency thoracotomy, that patient gets transferred to our nearby hospital because there is no cardiothoracic surgeon here. So, personally, I wouldn't be able to give any examples of what we have done, except that, you know, the kind of example which Dr. Richa said, it's amazing because many of these patients would die in any other center if you didn't do what, like, you didn't have the capability to open up and repair the heart, you didn't have a cardiothoracic surgeon, and you didn't have a good ED like you do in AIMS, where they could, you know, immediately focus on the thoracotomy and push him to theater within minutes. So I wouldn't be able to comment on specific cases, but this is a very multidisciplinary thing. Like, to achieve such an outcome in a patient who has any kind of injury to the heart requires a very coordinated effort between the emergency department, anesthesia, like a trauma team. And if system and structures are in place, then of course, even if they're already in place, then the outcomes will be better, because you need to have a good fast movement to the OT so that, you know, bleeding can be controlled and sutures can be placed. Yeah.
So coming to just a few things, you know, we just have a recap, though ma'am has covered everything very nicely. One thing is about hemorrhagic shock. Isolated, we have talked about chest trauma as such specifically, but chest trauma is part and parcel of polytrauma. So hemorrhagic shock, we all know acidosis, hypoxia, and hypothermia. This is what we get when we transfuse and try to resuscitate. And this further impairs coagulation processes. But what is also important to realize regarding the physiology of bleeding in these patients is that there is damage to the endothelial glycocalyx. This is a concept we should know, just, you know, basics. So what happens is the extreme acidosis and hypoxic state and the catecholamine surge leads to damage to the endothelial glycocalyx and shedding of this glycocalyx. And this leads to what has been termed autoheparinization of the blood, further leading to your bleeding tendencies. And at the same time, there is also a state of activation of procoagulant factors. So there is an imbalance between procoagulation and your anticoagulation, ultimately leading to more bleeding tendencies. The endothelial glycocalyx is the keyword here, shedding of the endothelial glycocalyx leading to your state of fibrinolysis, intense fibrinolysis. Now, ma'am, I talked about ARDS. Just to cover that, bilateral infiltrates on the X-ray in a patient with chest trauma or polytrauma. One is very simply, you can have bilateral contusion. And contusion is what? Inflammation, edema, hemorrhage occurring in the lungs, and it normally may not manifest initially in the first 24 hours. It may take a little more than 24 hours to bloom, and it subsides over a period of week. Conservative management, keep the fluids restricted wherever possible. And sometimes they have long-term consequences. These patients with pulmonary contusion can have long-term impairment in pulmonary function. And pulmonary contusion, if it's not visible on X-ray, is not serious. If after 48 hours, it's not there on X-ray, even if your CT shows something, it's not serious, but it can cause ARDS, one. So bilateral infiltrates, one, bilateral pulmonary contusion. And if there is a flail chest, there is very likely there's going to be a significant contusion. That is another thing. Then the other cause of bilateral infiltrates is your massive bilateral hemothorax, right? So that is, then you can get fat embolism. Fat embolism again can lead to ARDS kind of picture. Then you have, you can get fluid overload, you can get trolley, and very importantly, what is called shock ARDS, shock associated ARDS, because there is SIRS. Because there is SIRS, you can get this. You know, when there is polytrauma, it is SIRS. And you know, if there's hemorrhage, hemorrhagic shock resolves, right? You've taken care of the injuries. And we have seen that the blood pressure does not return to normal for some days. It remains at, you know, 90 by 60. So that is because of SIRS. And SIRS occurs within 3 days of initial trauma. If the blood pressure starts falling after that, it is something else. So that is one of the reasons why the blood pressure does not pick up sometimes after correcting your hemorrhagic shock, because there is SIRS going on. Now, moving on to flail chest. Flail chest, you know, as ma'am has described, the definition is broken into what more places and all that. So there is an inward movement during expiration and outward movement during inspiration of the flail part. And that is because during inspiration, you generate a negative pressure, right? The thoracic ribcage is generating a negative pressure. So it gets sucked in because it is not in continuity with the ribcage. The negative pressure that has been created in expanding the lung is sucking the flail segment inside, and vice versa occurs in expiration. Sometimes it is not easy to pick up the flail segment. Sometimes the movement is not easy to pick up. So please be aware of this. If you're not discerning the movement, it does not mean there is no flail chest. There are various theories are ascribed to it, that there is a recruitment of the nearby muscles, or there is splinting of the nearby muscle splinting action because of the pain. So some theories are there. And on the ventilator, you won't get flail chest movement. Once the patient in a positive pressure ventilation, the flail chest movement will go away. And the other things is rib fixation, we have covered very well. I have shown you the data also. Then there is something known as pulmonary laceration, which is beyond pulmonary contusion also, in which there is gross pulmonary hemorrhage. A cavity-like structure forms because of blood collection, and it appears as a solid opacity. And sometimes you have to do surgery also to remove that area. It becomes non-functional and is a shunt-like situation. So this was, I think, by and large, what I wanted to talk about. And lastly, trauma to the heart. So trauma to the heart, actually, you can have various forms of injury. Cardiac tamponade, ma'am showed you. Then you can have a rupture of the valves. You can have cardiac contusion, which can be picked up by ECG changes or troponin I or your echo. And then sometimes you can get actually even myocardial infarction in the elderly, because there's an extremely stress state. This is a stress state. So a small fragment of patients can actually get myocardial infarction also when there is cardiac dysfunction. So one should be aware of this. So that was a few things about my side. Ma'am has covered everything very nicely. But just to recap the whole thing, that was all I wanted to say. And if there are anything ma'am wants to add, ma'am, please, want to add anything? Dr. Richa, ma'am?
Dr. Tapesh, I just wanted to add that you can have MI because of coronary thrombosis per se also. So we've had the patients who had developed coronary thrombosis after the trauma, and they had MI because of coronary thrombosis also. And then patients who had stroke because of the, vessel laceration, internal carotid artery laceration, and they developed MCA infarct.
So we can have... Absolutely. So let me see, any questions are there? If you have any questions, please put them. I'll just wait for 2-3 minutes.
So since if nobody's asking, I'll just, for the sake of learning and making it interesting. So Dr. Richa, in AIIMS Trauma Center, what would you say is the most common modality of pain relief you're using in your ICU? In terms of, are you using any paravertebral block, or you're using PCA or epidurals, or just oral analgesics and IM or IV analgesics?
So Dr. Monica, we are using first the oral analgesics first, And if the patient does not respond, then we go to the systemic analgesics in form of opiates and NSAIDs, and also we go give epidural analgesia. But again, the proportion of patients who would really get epidural analgesia is very less. That is the tune of 16 to 20%, because thoracic or this injury is not on all alone. Yeah, yes. All the other factors.
Yep.
So, and we are not giving paravertebral blocks per se. Mm. Yes, but we have given intercostal blocks to some patients. And particularly, they were done mainly for the research purposes to see how they affect the pain relief.
Yeah.
Epidural analgesia per se has a very good pain relief. Yep. Very good pain relief. The patient really, after thoracotomy, elective thoracotomy, we're giving epidural analgesia to all the patients who are undergoing elective thoracotomy. Yeah.
Right.
Actually, that helps because, ma'am, pain relief is not there. So physiotherapy becomes very effective. And that helps in preventing atelectasis, retention of secretions and pneumonia, which is a major problem with the failed chest and rib fracture. So pain relief is of paramount importance and makes a lot of difference, because you can do incentive spirometry, deep coughing and all once the pain is relieved. Apart from percussion, you can practically do everything with your physiotherapy. So anything else, Monica ma'am, you want to add?
No, I just wanted to pay for centers and for where people are managing chest trauma, for smaller centers all over India. I think one of the highlights of chest trauma is pain relief. And starting, as Dr. Richa said, with simple oral or intramuscular or intravenous analgesics, a combination of, tramadol, panadol, and the newer NSAIDs is useful. And of course, if you have an anesthetist working in your ICU and you are an anesthetist-driven ICU who has regional skills, then paravertebral, intercostal nerve block and thoracic epidural are the options. And I think this is worth the discussion, because many of our patients will get undertreated because of pain, and that contributes a lot to their journey in ICU. That means they're worsening atelectasis, longer stay on NIV. So I think this sounds simple, but I think it's a highly neglected part where nurses play a big role in, because it's at the end, the nurse at the bedside who has to really assess the pain and get the doctor to, rechart the medications. So like in our hospital, we have patient controlled analgesia with morphine, and occasionally we'll get paravertebral box, but that's only occasional. And as Dr. Richa, you said, there are so many patients who have multi-trauma, and therefore epidural becomes, it's hardly done really. So we have a pain team who visits our ICU. The ICU is run by a special team, another team who are not anesthetists or intensivists, but some of them are not anesthetists. And since they haven't done regional for a while and they're not accredited, because so you end up basically depending on a pain team from the anesthesia department. But they do occasionally blocks. But again, the same problems as you mentioned of spinal trauma, coagulopathy, and prevention. So makes thoracic epidural not such a common affair, although you would desire it to be. Yeah,
but it's possible in isolated chest injuries.
Absolutely.
It really helps. Epidural works like magic.
Beautifully. Beautifully. Yeah, beautifully.
So I think, thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Richa Agarwal, ma'am. The wonderful cases once again for making the cases and presenting and sharing your experience. And thank you, Monica, ma'am. And I thank the audience for their patient hearing. Thank you, everybody. And thanks to Cipla for providing digital technology. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Richa. Thank you, Dr. Richa. That was wonderful. Thank you.
Same here. Pleasant meeting you.
Yes, I enjoyed listening to you, and it was great. You provided some very good cases. So it was wonderful.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.